Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Russellville First United Methodist Church. I'm so glad to see you here in person and those of you who have joined us digitally online today. I am Pastor Sarah, and here at this church, we want to be on a mission to make disciples who love God and love others. And there are ways that you can do that, and you can find some in your bulletin. So hopefully you have this with you, or you have downloaded it off online. And I'm going to talk about a few of the things on the back in the news to you section. The first is Manna House bags. Sorry. Manna House bags. So if you are here today, you can pick one of these up on your way out the door. There is a box of them there. If you are online, you can pick these up safely from the church office over the next 2 weeks. And you definitely can take more than one. But inside there is a shopping list of things that Manna House needs. And this is your opportunity to purchase a few items that will bless another family here in the River Valley as we feed families through the ministry of Manna House. So grab these. They are due back in 2 weeks. We pray a blessing over them before they head out into the community and fill people's tummies. The second thing I want to talk to you about, well, the second and the third are about things related to Advent and Christmas. Wow, it's here. We're getting close to it. And we're making preparations for a great Advent season. And one of the things, you've noticed we've been missing a choir, right? Well, for our Lessons and Carols service, there's no we involved. Mr. Layton is organizing this, our choral director. We're going to have a virtual choir that night. Not for all the songs, but some of them. And anybody can participate. You get to do this by yourself safely and securely, and then through the magic of technology and Layton's know-how, we will blend it all together to be a virtual choir for that night. And so if you enjoy singing, you are invited and welcome, and we would love to have you be part of all the voices of our virtual choir for Lessons and Carols. So you can contact Layton about that for more information. And then finally, as we're looking towards the holidays, we're wanting to put together a telecare team. And this is for anybody who can pick up a telephone and know how to dial. We want to help people feel a little bit more connected during the holidays. We know the holidays can be hard anyways, but especially this year with so much isolation that we've had and grief and loneliness, we want to care for our congregation through this season particularly. So if you are interested in being part of that telecare health, and it would be, you would have a script and you would be able to talk with people and encourage them through this holiday season, please get in touch with the church office so we can get you set up in that ministry. Well, with that, let us begin worship with our prelude this morning.
Thank you.
Let us stand together and be called to worship with the words of Psalm 78 today. O my people, listen to my instructions. Open your ears to what I am saying, for I will speak to you in a parable. I will teach you hidden lessons from our past. And known stories our ancestors handed down to us. We will not hide these truths from our children. We will tell the next generation about the glorious deeds of the Lord, about his power and his mighty wonders. For he issued his laws to Jacob. He gave his instructions to Israel. He commanded our ancestors to teach them to their children, so the next generation might know them, even the children not yet born. And they in turn will teach their own children. So each generation should set its hope anew on God, not forgetting his glorious miracles and obeying his commands. Let's sing our opening hymn together. The Lord be with you. Let us pray together. Lord, into your most holy presence we come. Calm our anxious spirits. Remove the distractions that would keep us from you here today. Break down the walls of separation that we have built to keep you at a distance. Lead us in joy and celebration of the only reality worth knowing. Free us for joyful obedience to your claim and call on our lives this day and every day. Amen. I'd like to invite Miss Page now to lead us in a moment for the children.
The sermon series, the title, The Good News about death. Last Sunday, in Sunday school, I asked the children and a couple of parents that were there what they thought that meant. And a little first grader immediately raised up his hands, "We get to see Jesus." Yes, yes. But in our scripture today, the Thessalonians are struggling with that a little bit. They're new Christians, and they have had some loved ones die, and they have a lot of questions. So Paul is trying to talk to them, trying to help. The first thing he says is, your grief is going to look different. So he tells them that their grief will be full of hope, right? So, and he lays that out in a way that looks like...
Here you
thank you.
Oh,
sorry. Now, trying again. So first thing he tells them is your grief is going to look different because you have hope, right? And the hope that they have is just like this, the little first grader said, right? Their hope is Jesus. And Paul kind of lays it out the way I heard it is what we say in communion. He lays it out and he says, Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. So he takes them back and talks about Christ's death and resurrection. And when you know that, then you have the hope, right? Because there is no hope without Jesus. But when we have Jesus rising, we have the greatest hope. And then he takes them forward, and he talks about Christ's return. And children, I don't feel like we talk about that as much. We talk a lot about, I feel like, about Jesus' death and resurrection, but we haven't talked a lot about his return. And so in the scripture today, it says that Christ will come down. And some scripture says the clouds will be rolled back, a trumpet will sound, and the angels, and all believers will be reunited with Jesus. There is that hope. That is why we have hope in our grief. And then the very last part of the scripture today says, encourage one another with these words. So when we do grieve, and we do, death is sad. It is real. It is painful. But when we do grieve, our grief doesn't only point us to Jesus. It points us to each other, and we share that hope. And what is that hope? Well, it's just like the little first grader said last week. We get to see Jesus. Would you please pray with me? Dear Jesus, we praise you as our Savior. We thank you for the gift of your word, and the hope and reassurance and peace it gives us. And we ask, Lord, that you please help us share that love and that hope with others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus. taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18.
Would you please stand as you're able for the reading of God's holy word? But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For the Lord himself, with a cry of command, with the archangel's call, and with the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. I'll add, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our Lord stands forever. And all of God's people said, well, good morning. It is good to see you this morning. My name is Tony Griffin, and I'm senior pastor of Russellville First United Methodist Church. And we are delighted to be together for worship this morning. We are thankful that you chose to worship with us here in person and online. And a special welcome to any guest who may be with us. We hope that you'll take time to get to know us and find your place at Russellville First. Well, I want to acknowledge this morning the difficult election season that we have been in, and in some ways we remain in. It has been a challenging time, and I want to acknowledge that and remind you that we are Christians. We are followers of Jesus Christ. Before we are American, before we are Democratic, before we are Republican, before we are anything else, we are children of God, followers of Jesus Christ, who live the way that he describes in Holy Scripture, which is a way that is very different than our culture. But Christians living in a democratic society such as the United States, we work for the common good. We work for all human beings. And so we pray for our leaders. We pray for our current president. We pray for the president-elect. We pray for all of our leaders in society and seek the common good for everyone. And so I just wanted to remind us that in the midst of all of it, and this truth, God is with us. God is with us, and he will not leave us nor forsake us, no matter what's going on in the culture around us. So I want to remind you of that. And today is the 23rd Sunday after Pentecost. So we're nearing the end of the Christian calendar. We're nearing the end of this calendar that we follow, which is different than the secular calendar. The Christian calendar ends with Christ the King Sunday, and then it all starts over again with Advent, that season of expectancy, that time of preparation, a time where we prepare for the coming King. We remember the first Advent and prepare for the second Advent of Christ. We remember the Nativity, the Feast of the Nativity, in other words, Christmas, and the 12 days of Christmas. It's a beautiful season. We're also in the sermon series, The Good News About Death. The culture around us doesn't like to talk about death, and when it does talk about death, it's usually a word of avoidance or denial about death in our lives. That's not the church's message. That's not the message of Scripture. Ours is an entirely different and hopeful story. Last Sunday's message was entitled The Other Side of the Curtain, as we remembered all saints and gave thanks for those saints that have gone ahead of us and the saints in our midst. We looked at the passage in Revelation that gives us a picture, one picture, and expands our imaginations of what heaven might be like as all the saints gather around the throne and worship. Well, today we are reminded that as Christians, when we grieve with hope. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your word that bears witness to the work of your love. And we ask that you would help us to hear you and to obey you. For we ask this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. As one pastor is fond of saying, the mortality rate for human beings is hovering somewhere around 100%. That's about right, isn't it? Because that is one of the certainties we say in life. There are death and what else? And taxes. Death and taxes. These are certainties. And death is the great equalizer. Death doesn't pay attention to our status. Death doesn't pay attention to the job that we had. Death doesn't pay attention to our education. Death doesn't pay attention to the things that we have accomplished, our status or our creed or anything else. It comes for every one of us. Death is no respecter of persons. Is it any surprise then that we have serious questions about death? It's the ultimate existential crisis that we cannot avoid. With that in mind, it may not surprise you to learn today that in this first letter to the Thessalonians, that is their question. What happens to those who have died before the return of Christ? It's possible that the Thessalonian Christians were asking that question because they were considering their own mortality and considering what may have happened to those who have died in their community before Christ's return. Because in the early church, they thought that Jesus would return before they died. So the deaths of loved ones presented a crisis in the community. And you see, most scholars agree that 1 Thessalonians is the earliest literature in the New Testament. Did you know that? 1 Thessalonians is the oldest piece of writing that we have in the New Testament. So Paul is writing to the Thessalonian church to help them with this issue and to encourage them in their work. Now, this is different than some of Paul's other letters, right? Because in some of his other letters, the community gets in trouble. He tells them what's going wrong, and he tells them ways in which they need to change. But in contrast to that, the letter to the Thessalonians is a word of encouragement. You see, Timothy had just traveled back from Thessalonica, which was located in the Roman province of Macedonia, and he was back with good news about this young church. Thessalonica now is modern Thessalonica, which is the second largest city in Greece. So the area and the culture around survives. So there's no real problem with the church in this first letter to Thessalonians until we get to the problem of what happens to those who die before Christ return. You can imagine how this pastoral crisis may have presented itself. They are waiting for the return of Jesus Christ. Someone falls ill in their community. They're doing the best that they can to take care of them and help them on the road to healing. But things aren't looking good. Things are looking bad. They're wondering what might happen to this dear one that is dying. And in turn, they wonder what might happen to themselves. So someone suggests, maybe we should contact Paul, our founder, and see if he has a word of pastoral counsel for us. So they do. And Paul does have a word for them. And Paul spends lots of time in his correspondence calling the believers to test what they hear before they receive it as truth. He says there are some things that you will hear that are good to the ear, but it's not necessarily good news. As Christians know good news. And he says this might particularly be true when it comes to death. At the core of the Christian faith is the good news of the resurrection. But it's a doctrine that's been revised time and again throughout history. It's a doctrine that's been revised by the Greeks, by the Egyptians, who believed that the soul went on to some sort of afterlife. And some of the Jews even believed in the resurrection at an end time. So simply to say that Christians believe there is something on the other side of death is not really to express the Christian hope. There is more to it. A Christian view of death, you see, must recognize the reality of human loss while at the same time delivering the living hope of eternal life. The United Methodist Funeral Liturgy, as many funeral liturgies do, begins with the announcement that we have come to praise God and to acknowledge our human loss, all at the same time. This is a truth that is our truth. This is a human truth. And maybe this is exactly what Paul means by grieving with hope. Paul never says that faith exempts us from the need to grieve. In the words of Brian Erickson, Christians know full well the pain of death, even death on a cross. Grieving with hope will always mean acknowledging our loss and taking seriously the sadness of others around us, while trusting that a larger epic is unfolding. In many churches, there's a powerful symbolic way of recognizing all that's going on in this. You've heard of pallbearers, right? Pallbearers at funerals serve an important task. And when we think of pallbearers, we usually think of the task that they have to carry the casket from worship to the hearse. And then the hearse travels to the cemetery and the pallbearers carry the casket to the grave. That is certainly something that pallbearers do, right? But what is a pall? Why are they called a pallbearer? P-A-L-L. What in the world is it? Well, pallbearers in some churches also bear the pall. They are the ones who carry the pall to the casket and spread it over the casket. And the pall is symbolic of holy baptism. You see, it's usually a large, fine, white, sheet-like piece of fabric that's placed over the casket. And think about holy baptism. When one is baptized, you take off the old garment of the sinful life and you put on the new garment of Christ. It's symbolized often in worship when the pastor wears a white robe, an alb, a garment of baptism, to remind us all that that is our garment. Christ is our garment. And we also know that by and through baptism, we find the pattern for life of daily dying to sin, rising to new life in Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the pall symbolizes the wonder and the power of God's life-giving work in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the pall serves as the great equalizer in the sense that death doesn't recognize the poor, the wealthy, or anyone else. Death is no respecter of persons. All that we came into life with was who we were and the baptism of Christ over us as a child of God, the claim of God upon us. All we leave in life with is that claim that God has placed upon us as a child of God. So the only thing we live with is the covering of baptism. Our hope is in Christ and in nothing else. But it also symbolizes this in baptism. Baptism is also a new birth. and death is a new birth. If we are practiced in the way of daily dying to sin, rising to new life in Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit, then we are used to dying in a sense. So death, in some sense, is the fullness of God's new life and the final transition from death to new life in Jesus Christ. It is a new birth. What if we were to take that to heart? What if we remembered that every time we hear of the death of someone? Craddock and Goldsmith, in the book Speaking of Dying, say, "Who are we? We are repentant, dead, baptized, removed from the world that pushed Jesus Christ aside. We have been emptied of one life and given a new one. We are people who have experienced a death, who know that dying is difficult, but who have found that in the new life in Christ is a better way, better in every way than a life in a world terrified of death." That is who we are. Nancy's son, Tripp, suffered from cystic fibrosis. As Tripp lay in the hospital in his final days, Nancy asked him if she could read some scripture to him to comfort him. She wasn't sure what to read him, and Tripp could tell that his mom was kind of fumbling as she was thinking about what to read him in these last moments of his life. And so he said, "Mom, just go to page 1649. See, 1649 was easy for him because number 16 was Montana, Joe Montana's number. And he loved Joe Montana. And 49 was the 49ers that Joe Montana played for. So he said, "Mom, turn to 1649. Well, she opened her Bible, but found her Bible only went to 1334. There was no page 1649, because at the New Testament in her Bible, it started over at 1. She was about to tell Tripp to try again when she did a little quick mental math in her head and said, "Well, that would mean 315 in the New Testament. That would be page 1649. So she turned there. And there she found these words from the Apostle Paul to the Thessalonian church. "But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others who do not have hope." Tripp turned to his mother and said, as his CO2 levels rising in his battered and damaged lungs, he said, "Mommy, those are the sweetest verses ever." My brothers and sisters, we live in the shadow of death, but we wait for the dawn. We grieve, but not as others do, for we're the people of hope. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us pray today. Let us pray by saying, "Lord, have mercy." God, today we pray for the Holy Church, that it may be filled with your truth and your love. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. We pray for Bishop Mueller and other ministers, and for all your holy people. We pray to the Lord, O God. Lord, have mercy. For all who fear God and believe in you, Jesus, that our divisions may cease and that all may be one as you and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who do not yet believe and for those who have lost their faith, that they may receive the light of the gospel. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those in government, especially for our current president and our coming president, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all those who live and work in Russellville, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees and prisoners and those in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this congregation, that we may be delivered from hardness of heart and show forth your glory in all that we do, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For our enemies and those who wish to harm us and for all whom we have injured or offended, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For ourselves, for forgiveness of our sins and for the grace of the Holy Spirit to amend our lives, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, for our family, our friends, our neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy and peace and health. We especially pray for Ray, Ward, Larry, Ron, Rick, Spencer, Rary, Bruce, Doug, and Lori, and the family of Jim. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all who have died in their communion of your church, that those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, only life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. Rejoicing in the fellowship of all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another in all of our life to Christ our Lord. And now let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now as we come to a time of offering, I want to remind you, if you haven't already turned in your commitment card for 2021, we'd ask that you would get that into the church office so planning can happen. And also, as we get ready to talk about the ways to give, if you are preparing a year-end gift, I know many of us do as we come to the end of the year, these ways to give apply to your year-end gifts as well. But before we look at that slide, I have a picture of you, of one of the ministries of our church. This is Social Distancing United Methodist Women. this is one of our circles gathered just in the past few weeks to fellowship together, spend time together, but yet remain safe. And so this is one of the other wonderful ministries of this church that connect women together, but also not just together, around the world in their mission and ministry that they do. And the next slide is ways to give, and you'll see those. Of course, today, if you're in person, you can we go ahead and switch that slide to the ways to give? Yeah, there we go. That's great. If you're here, you can drop it off in the offering plate when you leave, drop it by the church office. You can text to give, you can give on our website, you can give in a Give Now app. There are so many ways to give, and I hope one suits your family to give. But these work for your tithes and your offerings today, as well as your year-end giving. Well, let us give thanks to God for what he's given us and what we are giving back. God and Father of all, we praise you that all things which come to us are really yours. We're thankful that you provide for us financially, you provide for us spiritually, and you provide for us in so many other ways. We can't even list them all, the ways that you bless us. And so, Lord, we give you these tithes and offerings now, but more importantly, we give you our love, and we give you our praise. Amen. Thank you.
if you have sensed God's presence in your life today and have questions and you want to grow in the life of discipleship and would like someone to pray with, your pastors are available to you. Please don't hesitate to call us throughout the week or tap us at the end of the service outside. We would love to help you and encourage you. And if you've been thinking about membership and just haven't taken that step yet, I would love to speak with you about that. We in the United Methodist Church see the membership covenant as a means of grace, and I would love to spend some time sharing about that. The Lord is with us. Let's remain standing as we sing our closing hymn.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be.
Again, thank you for being here, and we pray for you throughout the week, and we are so thankful for all that you do to be a part of ministry at Russellville First United Methodist Church. As we go today, I want to remind you, we grieve, but not as others grieve. We grieve with hope. We live in the shadow of death, but we know that dawn is breaking. We are people of hope, and for that we say, glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we ask or imagine. Glory to Him from generation to generation in the church and in Christ Jesus forever and ever. And all of God's people said,
amen. Amen. Friends, as we prepare to leave this place, we want you to know that we are so glad that we have been in worship with you this morning. We pray that you have received a blessing by being here as well. Those of you who are in person, let me remind you, when we bind together, please just hold hands with those in your household. And once that is over, if you would be seated, you can enjoy the postlude as our ushers will come and usher you out one row at a time. So I want you to leave you with this reminder that we serve a God who redeems every circumstance, even death. And we live and we go forth in that hope. So go with hope and peace and love to serve the Lord. Amen.